Hello, in this video we are going to talk about brain aneurysms and the subarachnoid hemorrhage. My name is Dr. Kamran Aghayev. I'm an associate professor of neurosurgery. I work in Istanbul, Turkey. So aneurysms are not the diseases of the brain itself. It's the disease of the blood vessels that supply blood to the brain. What we have in this disease is enlargement of the wall of the vessel with ballooning, which becomes thinner and thinner down the road and may eventually rupture and cause brain bleeding. So, brain aneurysms are a peculiar disease that can happen in any part of the body, but mostly they happen in the brain because the brain arteries are very, very specific. They take a lot of load in terms of delivering the blood to the brain. As you may know, brain is about like 2% of our total body mass, but it takes 20% of blood flow. That means the blood vessels that supply our brain are taking too much load delivering the blood to the brain. And for that reason, the aneurysm in the brain are more frequent than aneurysm in other different areas. So if we have a weak spot on the wall of the vessel that supplies the brain, with the pressure inside that vessel being quite high, the wall is going to enlarge, to balloon. And with time, this balloon becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And eventually, it can break up, it can rupture and cause bleeding. Usually, this type of bleeding is called subarachnoid hemorrhage because it's a very specific type of bleeding. It does not bleed into the brain itself. It actually bleeds in between the brain and the skull, in between the covers of the brain. So the blood actually goes around the brain rather than being inside of the brain. So that's about the mechanism of aneurysm formation and subarachnoid hemorrhage. Aneurysms themselves do not usually cause any symptoms because they are quite small in the vast majority of cases. Okay, they have sizes approximately the size of the vessel that they're originating from. In some cases, they might be quite big enough to cause compression. They can push against something and that can cause symptoms. So for example, aneurysms of the carotid artery, if they're big enough, they can push against the third nerve and cause diplopia. Sometimes an aneurysm can push against the optic nerve and cause blurred vision. They can cause compression of the temporal lobe with epilepsy. But in the vast majority of cases, aneurysms themselves do not cause any symptoms, not even a headache. However, when they bleed, when they rupture, subsequent bleeding, subsequent subarachnoid hemorrhage, the patient usually presents with significant, excruciating, all of the sudden pain. They usually describe this pain as the worst pain, worst headache in my lifetime. And in addition to the sudden onset of headache, those patients complain sometimes about the loss of consciousness. Sometimes they may have seizures, but sometimes they may have nausea and vomiting. But in the vast majority of cases, the altered consciousness and sudden onset of severe headache is a major presenting symptom of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. Treatment of brain aneurysms depends on multiple factors, and one of the most important factors is whether the aneurysm has been bled or not. Okay, and that's a very, very crucial point, because if the aneurysm has not bled yet, it may not. If aneurysm has been diagnosed incidentally, let's say a patient had a MRI scan or a CT scan and there was a suspicion of the aneurysm and eventually aneurysm was discovered on the later imaging, the decision whether to treat this aneurysm or not depends on the location and the size and the age of the patient. Okay, so it's a little bit of complex issue which I'm not going to go into details, but some aneurysms may be just watched carefully for possible rupture. But in case if aneurysm has already ruptured, they should be treated. And the treatment actually has two branches: treating aneurysm itself and treating the subarachnoid hemorrhage. So treatment of aneurysm or closing the aneurysm will not eliminate the consequences of the bleeding, first of all. Treating of aneurysm is actually a prophylactic surgery, a surgery that eliminates the possibility of future bleeding, which is an important issue. However, the bleeding has already happened, will have severe consequences for the patients, consequences like a vasospasm and consequences like hydrocephalus that might or might not happen later on. Usually these patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage, they go through the period of critical period, which takes approximately a month and a half, when they can go through the period of vasospasm, which takes approximately 3 weeks, or they may develop hydrocephalus, usually, you know, in a period of few weeks or few months after surgery. Okay, so the two aspects of treatment of aneurysmal hemorrhage: treating the aneurysm itself and the treating the subarachnoid hemorrhage. When it comes to treating aneurysm itself, there are two techniques basically: endovascular and the surgical. With endovascular technique, the endovascular interventional radiologist or neurosurgeon who is doing the procedure is going from inside the vessels, usually from the groin area, from the femoral artery, all the way up to the aneurysm, and puts something inside the aneurysm or across the neck of the aneurysm to close the blood flow into the aneurysm. With open surgical treatment, what we do, we make a hole in the skull, and then we open the skull, not like this here, we just make a small hole and then go inside the skull, usually underneath the brain, not through the brain, underneath the brain, to reach the aneurysm. Once we expose the aneurysm, we put a surgical clip, a surgical tool that actually closes the neck of the aneurysm, so there will be no flow from the artery to the aneurysm, and the aneurysm will close. Both treatments, endovascular and open surgical, have their own advantages and disadvantages, which I'm not going to discuss here because it's a long discussion and there is an ongoing debate which is better, but looks like that the certain type of aneurysms, they are doing better with clipping, and the others are doing better with endovascular treatment. Thank you for watching this video about the aneurysms. You can find more information on our website.